Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It's a great joy for me to be with you today. I came yesterday and this late afternoon I will depart, but I am glad that we can be together and study the Word of God. I was here actually in Philippines in November last year. So I feel here like almost at home. And Friday evening I actually visited this place when we were here in November. So I am really privileged to be here and to open the Word of God with the theology students, because you are pastors and you want to serve the Lord. And what is great is that at the core of the theology we have very important message, and this is what we call Adventist theology. And we want to be shaped by this theology in our mind, in our heart, in our life, that everything what we do always from that perspective to the glory of God. That people around us, and not only we, will be also ready for the second coming of Jesus. Well, I was asked to talk about the judgment of God. This will be a series of four lectures, and each lecture will be built on the previous one. So this will be a series of four lectures coherently put together. So you need to really to follow up all four in order to have this good comprehensive picture what the Bible is saying about the divine judgment. And the first lecture is entitled The Divine Judgment. Is it good or bad news? And I would like to give the biblical answer. Maybe we can ask that question a little bit differently. How to expect God's judgment without going crazy? It's a good question, right? Let me start with a very important observation that at the heart of the eternal gospel, at the core of the Bible, at the very center of our sanctuary doctrine and our theology is the concept of judgment. So it is not something peripheral in the Bible. It's right in the very center. And this is what I would like first to convey very clearly. And this very centric biblical teaching is the heartbeat of Adventism. This is who we are. It is really the core and center of everything what we are doing. In Revelation 14, verse 6 and 7, you know that three angel message are preached, and this three angel message is considered as the gospel, eternal gospel. And what is at the center of that gospel? Three imperatives with the reason, justification, why we need to fear God, give Him glory, and worship the Creator. Why? Because the time of judgment is here. So you see that all our activities are done from the perspective that God is our judge, that the judgment is actually here. So let me ask you the simple question. What is the first picture about God in the Bible? What is the first picture? The first sentence in the Bible starts, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and earth." So you have the very clear message that the first picture about God is that He is our Creator. Well, what is the second picture of the Bible about God? What is the second picture? And maybe it will be a surprise for you, but the second picture of the Bible about God is that He is our judge. Because He's our Creator, we are accountable to Him. And this is why He is our judge. But what is very important, that it is the message again, right in the beginning, in chapter 3, Genesis chapter 3, you have this picture designation of God, who is our judge. But in the midst of his judging activity, he is presented as our Savior. And this is very important, this connection. We can recognize in the face of our judge the face of our loving, gracious Savior. Amen? So this is the first observations we need to have in our mind. Let me stress once again that God being our judge is not a peripheral teaching in the Bible, but it lies at the center of its message, right from the beginning. It is the pattern, God's pattern established in the Bible, and God's pattern in relationship to humanity. He is our judge. Well, let's see a few examples. You will take your Bible and you will see that right in the chapter 3, you have the first designation that God is our judge. You go to chapter 4, God is judging Cain, right? He's discerning between Cain and Abel. You go to chapter 6 to 9, you have judgment in relation to the whole humanity. You have the flood story. You go to chapter 11, you have the story about the Tower of Babel, the judgment. At the center of all chiastic structure there, you have the judgment of God. Then you go to chapter 18, 19, you have the judgment upon Sodom and Gomorrah. So I hope that you have now the imagery that page after page in the Bible, it's presenting God as our judge. So you see that there is no wonder that we as Seventh-day Adventists, we are taking the message of judgment as the center of our message, because it is at the center. God is our judge, and everywhere in the Bible, including three angel message, eternal gospel, at the center of it is the judgment. Well, let me give you an example of the book we love very much, the book of Daniel. By the way, we have all symbolic name Daniel. Do you know why? What is the meaning of Daniel? God is my judge. So, yes, we are worshiping our God, who is our judge. So, God is my judge, Daniel. Every one of you, including me, we have the name Daniel. And we are also the Laodicea church, correct? And what is the meaning of Laodicea? Laos and Dikaio, the people of judgment. And we are living in the time of judgment. You see how it's fitting? We are bringing the message of judgment, living in the time of judgment. We are worshiping the God who is our judge. We are Daniels, and we are the people of judgment. Everything is there together. And you can see how also in the book of Daniel, you have everywhere in each chapter the main point that God is the judge. And you can see this judgment slide, Daniel chapter 1. You have the God judgment upon Israel, unfaithful Israel, with the Babylonian army coming in Jerusalem. Then chapter 2, you have the stone who struck the statue. God's judgment is presented very clearly. In chapter 3, three friends are judged by God, and they were found faithful. And Jesus Christ was in the fiery furnace with them. Then you have chapter 4, judgment upon the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar. You go to chapter 5, judgment upon the last king of Babylon, Belshazzar. And you know the whole story. Chapter 6, judgment on Daniel. He was now very old, but he was found faithful, that even lions could not harm him. God had the protection upon him. You see the mixture? Judgment upon people of God, and judgment also upon those outside of the people of God. God is the judge, universal judge, judge of all planet Earth, and also the whole universe. And if you continue, you know, in chapter 8, you have judgment and 2300 evenings and mornings prophecy. Chapter 9, you have judgment and 70-week prophecy. And I can continue that each chapter is really full of judgment. But there is one chapter which is like at the center of the whole book of Daniel. And this center is chapter 7, right? And what do you have in chapter 7? I will go very quickly through that structure because it's so beautiful. Because the most elaborate chapter in the Bible about the divine judgment is Daniel chapter 7. You have nowhere the more better picture of God's judgment than in chapter 2. And you will have two scenes presented in chapter 7. So let me go very quickly through this two scenes, and you can notice that the first scene is in chapter 7, verse 9 and 10, and second is in chapter 7, 13 and 14. And the whole structure of Daniel 7 is very beautiful. You have introduction, and then you have the vision, then interpretation of the vision, and then epilogue, like conclusion. So let's go to see how it looks. You see that it's like with two T's there. And it's so beautiful. If you pay attention, you can see that there is something what's going on earth, and then what's going on in heaven. And you have what is going on earth written in prose, and what is in heaven is in poetry. It's such a beautiful language used because you cannot even describe with the human language what's going on in heaven. So you have prose poetry, and then you have interpretation. So vision has this two heavenly scenes, as you can see. And if I go very quickly through that vision, you can see that it has a very powerful structure. And at the center of that structure, literary structure, you have the notion of judgment. Presentation of that heavenly scene, the first scene about judgment, verse 9 and 10. And if you continue how it is nicely structured, you will see that again it is matching forth and back. And then you have the additional thing. And what is this additional? Again, the judgment of God. And then will be interpretation. So in the vision, you have these two heavenly scenes, and then after that comes interpretation, and in that interpretation, again, the main point will be like verse 22, which will speak about God's judgment. And we know that heavenly judgment scene very well, but let me remind you that Daniel is saying, I looked, and he saw the Ancient of Days. And then is the description of the beautiful being, what we would call the Heavenly Father. And then you have the statement, the court was seated and the books were opened. Maybe let me pause here and ask you the question. Let's say that you would be a journalist or a TV person who would need to describe for the whole public in the Philippines a special court situation when somebody famous, let's say the president of Philippines, will be judged because he would do something wrong, and you had such a situation, right? And you would be now the journalist or the TV person, and you would have only two possibilities how to describe that trial with the president. Only two shots. You can do two presentations for the whole public. What you would choose? I am sure that you will choose the beginning of judgment, because you will say, well, here is the president and he did this and that, he's accused of this and that. So everybody will be interested, well, what's going on? And then if you have only another possibility, what you will do? You would go and present the result. And this is exactly what we have in Daniel chapter 7. In verse 9 and 10, you have the beginning of judgment, and then it goes to verses 13 and 14, and you have the explanation, and then the final triumph of the Son of Man, which is Jesus Christ there, who is giving all the kingdom, all his victory to his followers. So it's very beautiful pictures. All right, so this was like the first insight that we can understand that what we are doing as Seventh-day Adventists, it is not something strange in the Bible. It's everywhere. It's at the center, it's at the core who God is. God is our judge. This is why the message of judgment is presented, and we are those who are presenting that judgment. So now we have to ask question, well, how to present God's judgment, right? What is the nature of this judgment? And this is what we will study very carefully this morning and also the first hour in the afternoon. And let me now start this closer look on the divine judgment with a simple question. And I would like that you will answer me that question. And I want that you will not answer theologically, but you will answer from your heart, okay? So, what are your first thoughts when you hear the word judgment? If I would come to you and say, well, God is your judge. God will judge you. What is now your feelings? Fear. Let me tell you that I ask this question in all continents of the world, to people of different education, of different political, setting in which they are living, of different group of people, young, older, old, and always, without any exception, the first reaction was fear. This is our human response. We fear that God is our judge. This is why we don't like to talk about judgment, okay? We fear God's judgment, and why to speak about something you fear, right? But let me tell you that this is natural reaction. Why it is natural? Because we are sinful. Even though we are justified sinners, we have still sinful nature, right? So we are alienated from God. We are saved by faith, but still we feel that we are so distant. And He's holy, and we have sinful nature. So this is natural that from the human perspective, almost humanistic perspective, yes, we fear. But now, let's go closer into it. Is it concept of fear really at the bottom of that message? Do we need to cultivate fear when we hear that God is our judge? Well, let me tell you that with that fear goes what? With the fear goes also condemnation. We know that God is holy and we are condemned. Unless He will do something, we are condemned. Then with condemnation goes punishment. With punishment goes destruction, and with destruction comes death. So this is our view of judgment. Tell me, what is the common element of all these 5 points? What is common element to it? The common element is that all is negative. You see, we are thinking about God's judgment in negative terms. When we hear the judgment that God will judge, we think, well, God will come and He will do what? He will condemn, He will punish, and He will destroy. Condemnation, punishment, destruction. This is what we automatically put into our mind. You hear the word flood, and what is in your imaginary? You see God's judgment. What does it mean? He came to destroy, to punish, to condemn. And this is our problem. And I would like to show it to you why it is so problematic. Let me tell you personally that I had the same distorted view of about God's judgment, and I thought that this is because I grew up in the communist country of Czechoslovakia. I thought that because of this oppression and this totalitarian regime, this is why I had this view. I thought that judge is somebody who is dressed in black, always with a severe expression in the face, then pointing with finger to someone, condemning to prison or to death. Well, I learned that this is not only my picture of God, but that many, many people has the same imagery, that God is like, you know, heavenly Nebuchadnezzar, who is there looking with the magnifying glass on us and, you know, seeing all our mistakes. So what he will do? He will punish. Or that God is like the heavenly policeman who is somewhere, you know, behind the bush, measuring our speed, our life, and then appear and find us. And this is what I discovered is not, it is not the biblical picture of God. But what is the result if we have such kind of picture of God in our mind? Well, the result is that there is no joy of salvation. And we have no also assurance of salvation, because everything is under the God judgment, and he is your judge, and you never know what will happen and how it will happen. So you have no assurance of salvation, and you have no joy of salvation. And on the contrary, our life, even a Christian life, is full of anxiety and full of fear. Well, why is it so? Let me give you, beside that general reason that we know that God is is a holy God and we are sinners, beside that general, you know, there are two theological reasons why we are seeing, you know, God's judgment in that negative terms. First reason is that we have a faulty understanding of judgment. We have very narrow definition. What does it mean that God is our judge? Very narrow definition, faulty definition, one-sided definition, negative one, as I already pointed. And the second one, you know, that we have some kind of dichotomy. We have isolation between the gospel and the judgment. Pastors will come to you, yes, Jesus Christ died for you, he saved you. And when you accept him as your personal savior, you are saved. And you confess your sins openly, honestly, sincerely to God. So you now rejoice in the plan of salvation. God is your savior. Glory, hallelujah, amen. And then the pastor will come to you and say, well, but remember, there is judgment. And suddenly all this glory, hallelujah, is melted, is like disappearing. And we are living with fear and with anxiety. And we have no assurance of salvation. And we are living in what I call biblical or theological schizophrenia. We are split in our mind. On one side, oh, I am saving Christ. Second, God will judge you, and suddenly everything is different. So what to do with that? And we need to really study it very carefully, because we need to put together gospel and judgment. We saw actually that the three-angel message is saying that the core of the gospel. And what is gospel? Good news, right? At the core of this good news is judgment. So if this is at the core of the good news, judgment must be good news. And we need to discover it from the Bible. So my question now for you is, very important. What is the primary meaning of God's judgment in the Bible? What is the primary meaning? And I would like to give you now four definitions. And I would like that you will memorize that very well. Put your notes. What is the biblical understanding and primary understanding of God's judgment? I don't want to deny, and listen carefully, I don't want to deny that there is also negative meaning of God's judgment in the Bible. It is there. It's a condemnation, punishment, destruction. But this is not the primary meaning. This is the secondary meaning. And I would like now to show you the primary meaning. What is really in view of the Bible when God speaks that God is our judge? So, quickly, four definitions. The first one, to judge means to justify. The whole concept of justification is really present in the statement that God is our judge. Every time when you pray and you ask God for forgiveness of your sins, and God is forgiving your sins, it means that you are passing through God's judgment. And God, because you are coming with your open, sincere heart, and you ask for forgiveness, He loves you and He forgives you. It means that He is now not only forgiving you, but what does it mean that He's forgiving you? He's acquitting you. You are condemned to death, but He's coming as your judge and telling you are no more guilty. You are justified. You are pronounced judge. It means that the God's eschatological judgment is like coming into your time. And now God, as your judge, is acquitting you, is pronouncing you just, He's forgiving, He's justifying you. So you see how important is the notion of judgment. Forgiveness is the language of the court. And when God is forgiving you, He is acquitting you from your guilt, from your sins you committed. So this is the first. To judge means to justify. Second, to judge means to save. The whole concept of salvation is included in the biblical teaching about judgment. God saves us from death, from eternal death, and gives us life, gives us eternal life. And this is perfect, this is very good news, that this is actually judgment is salvation. Let me continue. To judge means also to deliver. Well, the whole concept of deliverance, freedom, is in the notion of judgment. God delivers us from what? From our addictions to sin. Now, when God as our judge is not only pronouncing something, He's also doing very important things in our life. He's delivering us from the evil one. He's delivering us from the addictions, from our slavery to sin, and He's giving us freedom. And the fourth definition is that to judge means to vindicate. God is for us and never, never against us. He's vindicating, He's defending us against what? Well, God vindicates us against accusations of Satan. And this is very important to understand. There is a prosecutor who is against us all the time. He's accusing us day and night of things. But Jesus Christ is the one who is on our side. He's not only our intercessor, but He's also our judge. And God, our judge, is vindicating us against the accusations of Satan. And good news is that Jesus Christ already won over Satan on the cross. So the victory is already here. And we only need to accept this victory for us. So this is very beautiful. As you can see, We have now four meanings of judgment. And note carefully that all four meanings, these primary meanings, are now positive. All are clearly positive. To judge means to justify, to save, to deliver, and to vindicate. Well, let's say it together that we will have it in our mind. To judge means what? To justify, to save, to deliver, and to vindicate. Once again, what does it mean to judge? To justify, save, deliver, vindicate. Once again, to judge means to? You are excellent students, you have all A's. Yes, and this is very important to understand this issue. Well, now you can come to me and say, well, Dr. Moskala, well, we understand you are the dean of the seminary, so you have all this bringing to us. You were reading too many books, so this is why you are saying this to us. No, this is not because I was reading too many books. Yes, I read many books, but also I read very carefully my Bible. And let me now prove it from the Bible that all these definitions I gave you are correct. So let's go into that exercise. What is the book par excellence for us as Seventh-day Adventists which speaks about judgment? What is the book? Daniel, we already spoke about that at the center of all the book of Daniel, at the core, at the heart of that book is chapter 7. And in chapter 7 you have the statement about judgment. Usually people think that yes, Daniel 7 speaks about judgment, and this is about condemnation of the little horn. You know the story. But let me tell you that before this chapter will say something about the condemnation of the little horn in the interpretation of it, this will be something different there. And let me show it now to you. It's Daniel chapter 7, verse 22. And I will now read King James Version. And you have the statement, until the Ancient of Days came, you know, on the judgment scene, yes, you have it. So interpretation in verse 22, until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. And then the appointed time came, and the saints received the kingdom. So tell me, what is this meaning of that phrase in the King James Version, judgment was given to the saints? When you hear that, you think, well, judgment was given to the saints, it means that the saints will judge. Is it the meaning of that verse? Is it this meaning of that verse? No, because Daniel chapter 7 speaks about the heavenly judgment, right? And this heavenly judgment is going on in heaven from 1844. And we are not in heaven in order to judge. So what is the meaning of that phrase, judgment was given to the saints of the Most High? What is the meaning? This is the result of judgment in heaven, which is right now. This is pre-Advent judgment. So what is the meaning of it? Well, let me tell you that you need really to go to the Aramaic text, original text. Daniel chapter 7 was written in Aramaic. And you will see that in that phrase, you have a specific syntax, and in that syntax you have the lamet. Those who are studying Hebrew, you know that this is like a preposition, lamet, and then you have the rest of the sentence, and this lamet is now needed to be translated. And yes, it's true that you can translate lamet in the sense for. Or two, as it was here. Judgment was given to the saints. Direction, okay? But this is not speaking here about direction. It's speaking about the meaning of the judgment. So scholars today, because of the syntax, and I will not go into these details of the Aramaic language, are persuaded that this lamet is lament of advantage. So you need to translate actually as you have it in some other translations. Judgment was given for the saints of the Most High. And if this for means advantage, you can translate, yes, until judgment, until Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given in advantage of the saints of the Most High. Amen? And this is what you have in, for example, New King James Version, or you have it also in the NIV translation, NIV translate, until the Ancient of Days came, and pronounce judgment in favor of the saints of the Most High. Or you have in New King James Version, until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was made in favor of the saints of the Most High. In Aramaic text, you have the passive language, so it is the second translation is much better, that the judgment was pronounced in favor, in advantage of the saints of the Most High. So what is the meaning, the purpose of judgment in heaven right now? Tell me, this is for our advantage, in judgment in favor of the saints of the Most High. And you are the saints of the Most High. This is for your advantage. It is good that God is our judge, because if God is not our judge, he will not justify us, save us, deliver us, and vindicate. So praise the Lord that he is our judge, because all this we can experience in our life, because he is the one who is judging us. So this is the first example. Daniel 7:22. Remember that. Put, you know, the in a red or maybe in a, you know, gold, that verse in your Bible. After that, you have also condemnation for the other party, for the little horn. It's unmasking in the in heaven the you know, forces of evil, which play that they are the good ones, are unmasked in the whole, you know, judgment in the universe, because they need to understand also better this battle between good and evil. But Daniel 7:22. Now, second example. There is another book in the Bible which is helping us to understand what is judgment. And the whole book is also about judgment. Which one it is? The whole book is about judgment. Give me that book. Book Daniel, we already discovered. This is the one. But then there is another book which is helping us to understand what is the meaning of God's judgment. What is the book? Revelation. Well, this is plenty of about judgment, but it's not everything there about judgment. What is it's about victory, right? The whole book of Revelation is about that God won. Yes? So what is another book? The book of Judges. Surprise, right? You know, and the whole book of Judges, what is the primary function of Judges in the book of Judges? To condemn, right? To punish, to destroy. No. People of God were in the difficult situation. What they were doing? They were crying to God, Lord, please help us. Do something. Deliver us from the power of the enemies. And God sent judges. And what is the function of the judges? Well, to deliver God's people from the oppression of the enemies. They were the liberators. And they were caring for God's people. They were protecting them. They were saving them. And this is so powerful. So the book of the Judges should be called the book of deliverers. This is the book about freedom. And because at the bottom of concept of judgment is that God is making us free. We are no more slave to sin. We are free in him. We are led by the power of his word and the power of his spirit. we are different people. This is the meaning of God's judgment. All right, let me give you the third example very quickly. And the third example will be with three prayers of David. Do you know the three prayers of David? And it was also another fourth one in the book of Psalms. The sons of Korah, they are also praying the same prayer. And statement is in Psalm 7, 26, 35, and 43. And David is asking God, Lord, please judge me. Judge me. Well, like you have judged me, O Lord, my God, according to your righteousness, and do not let them rejoice over me. Well, let me now ask you, how many of you did already prayed or dared to pray this prayer of David? Judge me, O Lord! How many of you? You see, there is no one hand up. Why we are not praying this prayer of David? Because we are scared, fearing God's judgment. And David is praying to God, please judge me. He's not asking, please, Lord, condemn me, punish me, destroy me. What he's asking for? Lord, save me, vindicate me. There are so many enemies around me. They want to kill me. And I have nobody, but I have you. Please, Lord, you are my judge. Judge me, O Lord. Save me, justify, deliver, vindicate. This is the meaning. Well, I can go to many other, places in the Bible, but let me go to a few more to make the clear point. In Psalm 37, verse 38 and 39, you have the statement, all sinners will be what? Destroyed. You see, negative judgment. Clear negative judgment. The future of the wicked will be cut off, negative. There is also punishment and destruction, but it's only when you do not choose the first to be justified, saved, delivered, or vindicated. If you do not want God that he will do this for you, then this is, wicked will be cut off. Salvation. What? Salvation of the righteous comes from whom? From the Lord. Let me go to Psalm 76, 8 to 9. From heaven you pronounce judgment, and the land feared. This is natural reaction, and was quiet, because God is our judge. But this is not how it should be with those who are redeemed in Christ Jesus. When you, God, rose up to judge, he rose to do what? What is the interpretation? What is the opposition interpretation of that word, verb, to judge? You rose up to judge means to save all the afflicted of the land. Glory, hallelujah. You see, this is not my invention, that judgment means salvation. You have it here in the Bible. To judge means to justify. To judge means to save. And we saw already before that to judge means to vindicate and means also to deliver. Well, let me tell you, I can give you many other examples, but one more, which is my favorite. And this is Isaiah 35, verse 4. God is now approaching Isaiah and telling him, you will tell to people something very important. And tell this to people who are fearful, who are fearing. And we all, humbly admitted that we all are fearing, okay? We are scared of God's judgment. So God is coming to Isaiah, say to those with fearful hearts. It means to all of us. What he needs to say to those with fearful heart? Be strong. Do not fear. Be strong in what? In your achievements? In your performance? In your doings? No. Be strong in God. Be strong in faith. do not fear. Why? Your God will come. He will come with vengeance. Wait a moment. If God is coming with vengeance, you will fear even more, right? He will come with divine retribution. And when you hear that, you are even smaller now. But when God is coming with vengeance and with divine retribution, he is coming to do what? To save you. Amen? Please say it loud to yourself, this word of God. Don't say it only to others, but say it to yourself. Memorize it. That to judge means to justify, to save, to deliver, to vindicate. You need to have it fresh in your mind, because otherwise this used understanding of judgment in negative terms will overrule all this good news of the Bible. And you need to be very active in your faith. Be strong in faith. Be strong in God. Do not fear, because your God is coming with vengeance, with retribution, to save you. So God is coming to save all of us. Please say it to your friends. Say it to, if you are married, to your husband, to your wife. Say it in your churches. Please preach on this text, because this is the core of our Adventist message. We are not preaching judgment in order to scare people, but we are preaching in order to give them assurance of salvation, which is in Christ Jesus. There is no condemnation for those who are in Jesus. Please, you need to maybe rethink everything in your mind and do it biblically, from the biblical theological perspective. So you already understand why I am so excited when I speak that God is my judge. Because this is magnificent biblical teaching. God is my judge. He is the one who is on my side. Never against me, but for me. He is justifying me, saving me, delivering me from my addictions, and from the slavery to sin, and vindicating against my enemy. He's doing everything possible in order to save me. So I should have a joy of salvation, correct? You know, we associate judgment with fear. But the Bible associates also the judgment, God's judgment, with joy. Let me now go to one text, and only one, because my time is coming with that first presentation to the end. Psalm 96, 11 to 13. And I will now read only verbs that you can get the point. Rejoice, be glad, be jubilant, sing for joy. Sing before the Lord. And why? Why we need to be so excited here and full of joy? Because God is coming. He comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the people in his truth. Do you see that? Joy and judgment is now connected together. You can rejoice because God is your judge. So the portrayal of the Lord bursting into joyful cheers over his people is also without parallel in texts like Isaiah 6:2 or Zephaniah 3:17 and some others. I will not go into it. But I hope that you noticed so far something very important. I am the professor of the Old Testament, and everything what I presented here was done, and all examples from what? From the Old Testament. Because I want to show you that the Old Testament is the good news as New Testament is good news. The God of the Old Testament is the same God as the God of the New Testament. The God who created us is the same who brought Israel out of Egypt. This is God of prophets, and this is also the God of Jesus Christ. The God who created us is the same one who died for us. And this is the harmony. But in order that we can see it also from the New Testament, let me give you these two examples. John 2:28, and now, dear children, continue in him. So like, stay in him, so that when he appears, we may be confident and unashamed before him at his coming. This term, confident and unashamed, in Greek is the word parousia. Maybe you know the word parousia, right? Parousia is the second coming of Jesus. But parousia is bold assurance. So when you think about the second coming of Christ, you can have what? Parousia, bold assurance. You can come with confidence and unashamed before him at his coming. Amen? And in John 4:17, you have that we can have this parousia on the day of judgment. Wow, you see, it is not my invention that I am playing with words here. No, it is at the core of God's message in the Old Testament and also in the New Testament. So in now conclusion, let me bring it very clearly. Today, when I speak about God's judgment, I don't see God who is frowning and, condemning somebody. Today, when I speak about God's judgment in relationship to God's people, I see God's large smile on his face. This is our God. This is the God, our judge. He is for us, never against us. This is why we can have this full joy of salvation. You know, judgment is actually our only hope. If you would be in the cell, in prison, and then you will be condemned to death, so you are only expecting death, right? But if somebody would come to you and will say, well, there will be a new judgment in your situation. What does it mean for you? Hope. And if we understand that we are all in the death cell, we are all expecting to be executed because we are sinners. But God is coming. No, I am your judge. I justify you, save you, deliver, vindicate. Suddenly, this is different perspective. Judgment is our only hope in life. Let me also tell you that don't confuse biblical understanding of the court with our today's situations with the court in our Western world. You know, we, in our court system today, we have different people, but let me stress especially two. We have judge, and we understand the judge is the one who is condemning and, judging, and the attorney. And we understand that attorney is for our defense. So you have two different persons with each doing a different function. How is it in the Bible? Let me tell you that in the Bible there were no attorneys. Why no attorneys? Because the judge was your attorney. There were two functions we today separate, but in the biblical time these two functions were in one person. This is why your God is not only your judge, but he's also your attorney. He's the one who is for you. And first of all, he's always for you, and he will do maximum everything in order to save you. And only when he cannot, then you are staying under the condemnation. So we need to train our mind to think positively about God's judgment. And only when the positive meaning does not make sense, then we need to put the negative statement into God's judgment. Let me ask you now, tell me if I am right or wrong, okay? Our God does not need to organize a judgment in heaven in order to condemn us. This is my statement. God does not need to organize a judgment in heaven in order to condemn us. Right or wrong? Is it right or wrong? And those who are answering that it is right, I am on your side. Why it is right? Because we are all already condemned to death, and God does not need to do it for the second time. If God will do nothing, I repeat once again, if God will do nothing, you will die and die eternally. But the good news is that God is doing something, something very important. He is calling the whole judgment in heaven in order to do what? To present our cases there, in order to show that we accepted him as our personal savior. And he's now demonstrating there, affirming what we have in with personal relationship with him. And God is calling judgment in heaven in order to legally secure our place in heaven for all eternity in front of the whole universe. Amen? This is why we have and we need today what we call a pre-advent judgment. The judgment which is right now going on in heaven. It's a good news and not a bad news. It's an exciting news, and you can see how excited I am when I speak about God's judgment. Yes, the primary goal of all judgment of God is to restore us, so that we are sons and daughters of God. Yes, we are saved by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ. This is the foundation of the eternal gospel. This is the core and basic theology of judgment. And as I said, this is the only solution for us. If someone is condemned at the judgment, it is not because he or she is a sinner. Do you agree with me? I repeat once again, if someone will be condemned at the judgment, it will be not because he or she is a sinner. Because we all are sinners. But if it will happen, it will be because that person did not accept the solution to his or her situation of sin, namely, not accept Jesus Christ as the personal Savior. Amen? So it is, yes, sin and our sinful situation is terrible. This is why we are condemned. But this is not the tragedy of all tragedies. Tragedy of tragedies is when we refuse solution for this situation in which we are born and in which we live. God has solution. He is our judge. He is justifying, saving, delivering, and vindicating all those who want to follow him. And this is perfect. We are saved not because we feel good or we feel so, but because God said so. God said that we are saved when we accept him as personal savior. Whatever feelings you have, this is not primarily. The word of God is the main point. Like in 1 John 3:20, it is stated, if your heart condemns you, maybe your feelings for now, don't pay attention to your feelings. Pay attention to God's word, his proclamation to you. God is greater than our heart. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus purifies us from what? All sins. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. And Romans 8:1 says very plainly, there is therefore no, and there is not now no condemnations for those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen? So what is the God's judgment? Bad news or good news? This is not only good news, it is the best news for us. It is exciting news. So what does it mean that God is our judge? To judge means to justify, to save, to deliver, to vindicate. Once again, to judge means to? God bless you and stay strong in that faith, in that word of God for you. Amen.
I'm requesting somebody to bring a chair here while I will be facilitating the question. Then the one who will answer the question, Dr. Muscala, will be sitting here. Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. Every time that I heard this presentation, I'm so excited. And then I discovered, Dr. Muscala, that you did not write everything on your article about the good news of the judgment.
Yes, yes.
There are a lot more that you have mentioned that I did not find in the article that I have read from the publication. Okay? We have only 15 minutes for the question and answer. So you need only to ask the most important questions, the question that matters between life and death. Foolish questions, we are going to discuss that in the classroom. So only the most important questions, okay? So I understand that there is a box here, but is there empty? So the question is empty. Okay? Now, is there anybody from those who are listening that has that are going to ask questions? Because nothing is here. Maybe you were so excited during the presentation that you forgot to write your questions. Any Brother Grins? Maybe give him a microphone.
Thank you so much, Pastor, for your wonderful presentation. We were saying that the devil is coming and accusing us of our sins, but we're also saying that we will not be, if anyone is going to be condemned, it is not because he is a sinner. Now, what if Satan's accusations are right against us?
So what if the accusation of Satan is right?
Well, this is a very good question. I am glad that you are twisting it now from the other side, okay? Satan can be right when he's accusing people of sin. But as I said, when he's accusing us of sin, this is a tragedy, but it's not tragedy of all tragedies. What you will do with the sins. You know the story about Luther, for example, that I don't know if it is true or not, it's maybe a made story, but one day he was struggling with, Satan, who came to him and said, well, what are you doing? You are full of sins. He responded to him, all right, well, tell me what are my sins? And he was starting and writing the whole list of sin, and he asked him, this is all? Is it really all? And he added some more and more. And he said, do you have complete list now? And he said, yes, this is all why you deserve death. So you cannot reform. You are a sinner as all others. And then he said to him, well, now take an ink, put it in the red, and cross it out write there, the blood of Jesus Christ purified me from all the sins. This is the point, okay? Yes, Satan is right when he's speaking about sins. And the sins are the reasons for condemnation and for the death, but should be not the reason for our eternal death. We are not condemned at the very end because we are sinners. Because if it will be like that, we will be not responsible for anything. But we are condemned only because we did not find an accept solution for this tragic situation in which we were born. If you want or not, you were born with sinful nature and with condemnation. You were out, but Jesus Christ came to our, big hole and took us up. And if you want to stay in the hole, you want to stay in the pit, you want to stay in the mud and not to be taken out by Jesus Christ, so this is our responsibility. And this is what I was talking about.
So do not be afraid, because the Bible says, greater is he who is with us than the one who is against us. Okay, Dr. Molina.
Thank you, Dr. Marscala, for the very nice presentation. I am not a theologian, and I am encouraged with your presentation. But the idea is still torturing me sometimes, the idea that I got when I was here long time ago. You know, when we talked of the pre-Advent judgment, you know, we know that there is a judgment going on now. And our teacher said before that, yes, I know that, there is the judgment is positive, justified to save, to deliver, to vindicate, and it's very good. And Jesus is with us. But he said, you know what? When the books in heaven is opened, and at that very moment your name is opened, and you have some sins unconfessed, and we do not know when will be the book will be opened, and when we do not know will be your name will be judged, and you have some sins unconfessed, then you are done. You are judged. You are condemned. And, you know, sometimes it comes back into my mind, and how could you reconcile that idea that the judgment is good news, you know, because intentionally and consciously, sometimes we sin. My question is, how do you reconcile that good news that we are justified, we are delivered, we are saved, with the idea that the judgment in heaven is going on, and when your name is opened and you have some sins unconfessed, because we do not know when will be our name will be opened. Please help me reconcile that idea.
This is a very serious question, a very important one. How is it with the pre-advent judgment? We need to stress that pre-advent judgment is an antitypical work of the Day of Atonement, right? And what was the main point? And I will speak this afternoon about the pre-advent judgment, so I will only say a few things now. So in the afternoon will be a more bigger exposure of it. But what was the main point in the Day of Atonement? Was it about us? No, it was about things God's people confessed all what was, under God's control already, that now, in the Day of Atonement, will be completely dismissed from the sanctuary. So the Day of Atonement was not about sinners, it was about the activity of the high priest. And we usually forget that everything in Leviticus chapter 16 is concentrating what the high priest is doing. And what he's doing, he's going from, purifying himself, and then he's going from one place to another in order to make this solution for the presence of sin complete, that will be completely dismissed. This sin was already dismissed from the life of people. It's on in the sanctuary now, and now all what was confessed is now taken out to the from the sanctuary to the desert. Okay, this is the first thing, the imagery that everything in the Day of Atonement is not about us, it's about the high priest. All right, now, Ellen G. White, I think, has a very good point when she speaks that what will be presented in heaven is what? It's our case. Not our sins, but our case. What does it mean? That our life will be presented. What in our life we did with that good news that Jesus Christ died for us. And now in that pre-advent judgment, which is right now in heaven, It's demonstrating what is orientation in our life, what is our directions of life, where is the compass of our life. Is it for sin or is it for God? You know, yes, Jesus Christ will openly say that we are fragile, we did many, many things wrong, but do we always, when we realize that we did something wrong, what we did? We came back to Jesus. And this movement, this orientation on Jesus, this attitude to Jesus, this is what is the most important. And this is what will be actually presented in heaven. And as you can will see in the afternoon, I will speak about the pre-advent judgment with different terminology. I will speak that pre-advent judgment for us as believers is not investigative. God does not need to investigate. We do not need to investigate. This is our life, our case is there. What does it mean? God is bringing our case and affirms in the whole universe, in front of the whole universe, what is our attitude to Him, because He's not inventing something new. He's not adding something new or distorting things. He's what is our attitude, what is our orientation, that it is for Him. This will be presented, and on that basis, that He died for us and we accepted Him as our personal Savior, and the fruit of this decision can be seen in our life gradually on that basis, that we are open to God, that He can change us, even though it's not yet everything there, but we are cooperating with Him, that He can we can be more and more like Him, that on that basis we are saved. So it's not now that the second is now my name, for example, there, and now I have to be fearing. No, because I every day am with Christ Jesus and I follow Him and I am staying in Him. So I don't need to worry. And this is why there's no contradiction here, that we can have this parousia, bold assurance for the day of judgment. Because Christ is our righteousness, and I will speak later today how it works, because now will come this second question, how the gospel and judgment can be put together. And I will explain more to it. Okay?
Okay, it's time now for the next presentation. So we don't have time anymore for your additional question. There is a break for 5 minutes, and then we will go to the next. Okay, and then we will proceed to the next presentation. So those of you, the question box was there. You should have written your question there, and then we should have evaluated that one, okay? Thank you, and let's proceed to the break.